Well, hello everybody and welcome again to yet another OpenShift Commons briefing. We're really thrilled to have a new OpenShift Commons member with us today, Aporeto, to talk about a very new topic to me, application segmentation for using on top of Kubernetes or anything that's Kubernetes ready, and definitely means it works with OpenShift. So we're real pleased to have them come on board and explain what they mean by application segmentation and how it adds value to the ecosystem. So without further ado, I'm going to let Dimitri and Bernard walk us through what they're doing. And you can ask questions in the chat. We're going to let them do their demo and their talk for about 20, 30 minutes. And then there'll be Q&A at the end. And this whole thing is being recorded and will be posted on Monday morning on the blog.openshift.com. So Dimitri and Bernard, welcome to the OpenShift Commons, and please tell us all about what you're doing at Aporeto.
Thanks, Diane. Thanks for inviting us and giving us the opportunity to share with the community what we are doing here. As Diane mentioned, we are from Aporeto. I'm Dimitri Stiliadis, and I have with me Bernard van de Val, that is going to help us with the demo. And we're going to talk about the problem of application segmentation. As Diane said, this is, might sound like a new term. It's not so much a new issue, let's say. It's probably a new term for an old issue. And the main problem that we're going to discuss is that of application security. As applications are deployed in an environment like OpenShift or Kubernetes, or in the more general sense, in a distributed environment. What we're going to talk to you about today is Trireme. Trireme is an open source project. Trireme is essentially a library that allows you to implement this type of security functions, and we'll explain them in detail. And it also provides a Kubernetes integration, and because it's transparently installed in Kubernetes, it's also very useful to the OpenShift community. As you will see, one of the key value propositions of the key benefits of Trireme is that one can achieve actually security on an OpenShift deployment with very little operational complexity. Probably the biggest benefit out of the Trireme approach is exactly that, is operational complexity, is simplifying actually the operational deployment of large OpenShift clusters while at the same time providing security. So let's try to a little bit give an overview first of what we are going to talk about. So we'll explain what is the security problem and what is happening in the Kubernetes community in order to address the security problem. Kubernetes introduced in the 1.3 release as an alpha or beta API the option of a network policy. A network policy essentially allows someone to partition workloads and create a policy that will define when workloads can exchange traffic or when they are not allowed to exchange traffic. And what this does is it limits the attack surface of workloads. It can be used for governance reasons, because you want to separate a dev application from a production application. It can be used for security reasons, because you want to isolate a public-facing workload from an internal-facing workload. Now, although Kubernetes introduced the API for network policy, and I believe this API is slated to become official or move out of the beta phase in the next Kubernetes release, and I believe also in the next OpenShift release. However, it is just an API. It doesn't describe the implementation. The implementation is left actually up to third-party integrations to figure out how to implement this network policy. So Trireme is one such implementation, and the key value, the key idea of Trireme is that instead of using network tricks, instead of using networking techniques like VXLAN or using network ACLs or whatever, it introduces a transparent end-to-end authentication and authorization function inside Kubernetes. So what this function does is essentially it provides an identity to every workload in Kubernetes, and it guarantees that two workloads will only interact, can only exchange traffic, if you want, if the policy, if there is a policy that allows these identities to exchange traffic. The underlying assumptions for network are very simple. It just requires no complex network in order to deploy something like that. It assumes the very simple Kubernetes model with a subnet per host, and we'll discuss this in more detail. And because it simplifies significantly the network requirements, it makes the deployment of large clusters actually very simple. And last but not least, the technology, because exactly it doesn't depend on infrastructure, networking techniques, or anything like that, it can be deployed seamlessly, whether it's on a private cloud or whether it's in the Google Cloud Engine or AWS or wherever, because it doesn't really interact with the infrastructure or does any routing tricks or anything like that in order to achieve the security isolation. So what is the application segmentation problem? The application segmentation problem is actually something very simple, and it's probably one of the most used security policies in any environment. If I have two applications, A and B, and these applications can be not just one instance, right? It's obviously each one of them can consist of from hundreds of containers running all over a cluster. But if I have two applications, A and B, I want to guarantee that they can only exchange traffic, they can only communicate if they are explicitly allowed by policy to communicate. And there are two reasons that people select to do this. The one reason is isolation. I want to isolate my dev environment from my production environment. And the other reason is reducing the attack surface. Essentially, if application A, for some reason, gets pwned and somebody takes over, they don't necessarily have access to talk to everything in my data center, but they have very limited access to where they can go and what they can do. Now, in order to solve this problem, over the years, we have looked at the network and network techniques to address this problem. So we have used in virtualization environments or in private data centers, we have used VLANs, we have used VPNs. We have often used network virtualization with VXLAN. We have used SDN techniques. AWS have security groups, Docker introduced libnetwork. There is a whole set of networking level techniques that have been used in order to provide this isolation. A classic method, we'll describe it a little bit in more detail, is I put application A in one virtual network domain, a VXLAN domain, I put application B in another VXLAN domain, and they cannot talk to each other. Now, all these techniques fundamentally, they identify applications or application components by IP addresses, and then they use rules around the IP addresses to try to achieve this isolation. And although this is viable and possible, it has some significant scaling issues and some significant operational issues. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the scaling and operational issues of these traditional networking techniques. But before I do that, let me explain a little bit the network policy API that is becoming available as mainstream in Kubernetes, and it's already available in a beta version, right? So Kubernetes introduced this API as a mechanism for a user to define the set of pods or the set of services that can interact with each other. So a client can use this API to define a policy on the Kubernetes master, and then Kubernetes has the ability to push this policy to external policy controllers, and then the policy controllers will implement the security policy down on every host that is deploying Kubernetes pods. So in this architecture and in this implementation, the Kubernetes upstream tree includes the capabilities for the API and for storing the API and providing the notifications. However, it doesn't include the policy controller. The policy controller is something that usually is delegated to SDN systems, and there are several solutions out there that implement this type of network policy using some of the networking techniques that I described earlier, and we will go into a little more detail. What you will see that is happening with Trireme, we provide a native implementation with Kubernetes without an external policy controller, and that's already simplification number one, because there is less components to manage to begin with, but also we provide better security by doing this. So what is an example of a network policy in Kubernetes? I'm showing here a standard API example of a YAML file that is, or a JSON file that describes a network policy. And what we describe on this API in Kubernetes is that there is a network policy. It has some metadata, and then there is a specification. And the specification has essentially two components. It has the allow component that says from which pods is a set of pods allowed to receive traffic from. So the pods are defined through label selectors. So for example, here we say that from all pods that are on the front end segment, we're willing to accept traffic. To which ports are we willing to accept traffic? So here, for example, we say we're willing to accept traffic on port 80 from these other pods that are tagged with these labels. And then finally, there is a pod selector that says to which pods this policy applies. So in the particular example, for example, we say that this policy will apply to all the pods that are labeled as segment backend, right? So this is a very generic policy framework that essentially allows somebody to define through pod selectors, through label selector, sets of pods that can communicate on particular protocols and ports with specific destination pods. And you can understand now why this type of policy enables a security framework into Kubernetes, a very strong security framework, because now applications can be separated arbitrarily based on the user requirements. As I mentioned, this is an API. This is a policy definition. The question is now, how is the policy going to be implemented underneath in a Kubernetes cluster? So in order to understand how this can be implemented, and there are several networking techniques to achieve that, one has to go back and see a little bit how networking is achieved in containers and Kubernetes more specifically. So as I mentioned earlier, one of the techniques that can potentially be used for this type of technology and what Docker provides with LibNetwork is the ability to partition, to create multiple virtual networks that are attached to every host. This is a classic technique that comes actually from the OpenStack inheritance, if you want, where OpenStack has similar techniques, where essentially there are multiple virtual subnets. The virtual subnets use VXLAN to isolate themselves. And then because there are multiple virtual subnets, as containers get activated, they get activated on a different virtual subnet. Now, although this can provide some type of isolation, it turns out that, first of all, it's not very compatible with Kubernetes because Kubernetes has a different model. And in addition to that, it creates a lot of complexities. It creates complexities because in order to send traffic now between the subnets, somebody needs gateways, somebody needs complex routing tricks. Alternatively, somebody can have multiple interfaces on every pod. This creates other complexities around applications needing to know what's their default route and so on. Maintaining state for the subnets can become very complex. In a lot of solutions, it uses routing protocols like BGP in order to achieve that. In other solutions, somebody can potentially use etcd, but maintaining convergence for this becomes a challenge. So although it's a viable solution, it ends up being a very complex solution. Because exactly for this reason, the Kubernetes and OpenShift models are actually much simpler than that. So the classic Kubernetes networking model says that for every host, we actually allocate a subnet. So we give, for example, a /24 or a /26 subnet on every host. Every container, every pod on the host gets an independent IP address out of the subnet. And then we have a static routing throughout the infrastructure of the data center that will forward traffic destined to these particular pods over to the specific host. The infrastructure becomes extremely simple. It's very static, actually. Somebody, and I'll show you an example of this infrastructure, but there are no route updates. There is nothing that needs to happen in the network every time a container is started or stopped, every time a pod is started or stopped. Everything pretty much on the network is static. Network is very simple. It's just one additional route per host. So everything is very nice. However, every pod in this architecture can talk to every other pod. There is no essentially isolation. There is no security. There is no partitioning. Every pod or every container can directly interact with every other pod, irrespective of whether they belong to the same Kubernetes namespace or they belong to different Kubernetes namespaces, right? So there is no isolation in this infrastructure. in this type of approach. And this is the challenge that the Kubernetes network policy tried to achieve. Can we add essentially a form of isolation for the workloads on top of the simple infrastructure without making the infrastructure very complex? So an example of this infrastructure is shown in this type of picture, where I have a leaf switch or a top of rack switch, and I have hosts, and then every host just gets a subnet, and they get a subnet out of a much larger subnet. They get a /24 subnet out of a much larger subnet. And every pod now gets associated with an IP address out of the subnet. And everything in my network is layer three. Load balancing is layer three, or high availability can be done with layer three techniques. I don't need to worry about bonding. I don't need to worry about layer two tricks. I don't need to worry about anything in my infrastructure. This is the simplest form of infrastructure for supporting a Kubernetes cluster. And it actually works equally well in an environment like the Google Cloud Engine, or it will work in an environment like AWS, as well as on a physical infrastructure. So since the infrastructure is so simple now, how do we deal with the network policy thing, and what are the challenges there? So the classic approach, or the approach that most networking techniques use in order to solve the segmentation problem or the network policy problem, is by using access control, is by using ACLs. So in the case where you try to use ACLs, if you assume that application one consists of a number of pods, let's say 100 pods, and application two consists of another 100 pods, then the network-based solutions will end up introducing an ACL rule that says this particular pod can talk to pod one, and they can talk to pod two, and pod three, and so on. Essentially, in order to cover application segmentation using ACL rules, somebody ends up deploying n square number of rules. If I have n pods, I will end up deploying a quadratic number of ACL rules. And this can work for like an application with five or six pods, but as you scale up and you have hundreds of applications with hundreds of pods, then this becomes a significant convergence challenge. To illustrate why it becomes a convergence challenge, assume that an application scales up, application two scales out, and it adds a pod. The moment we add this pod for application two, what we need to do in the infrastructure is go back and update the ACL rules on all the other hosts, saying that now this pod can talk to the new pod, and this other pod can talk to the new pod, and the other pod can talk to the new pod. And this creates significant challenges, both in terms of complexity, of control plane complexity, as well as it depends on in terms of the number of ACLs that somebody has to deploy. If you see how this is done in a Linux host, this is done usually using something like IP tables. And IP tables has this locking property that every time you write something, you need to read the whole table and write it back in. And as you add a very large number of ACLs in order to achieve something like that, the update of IP tables can take several hundreds of milliseconds. So this becomes a problem. The control plane convergence can take a lot of time. Assuming you have thousands of pods over there or a large cluster, the update of saying to every host what new ACLs to add or remove every time a pod gets activated becomes a big control plane problem. So we fundamentally think, and we have seen this in real deployments, we fundamentally think that such techniques cannot really scale, and they don't match, if you want, the intent or the mentality of cloud-native applications and scale-out applications. So what is the fundamental problem here? And that is a little bit of a philosophical thing that we wanted to discuss, is that there is an inherent assumption everywhere that network reachability means authorization. Essentially, if two pods can reach each other through ping, let's say, then this means that they are authorized to talk to each other. What we realized is that we actually need to decouple these two very important terms over here. Network reachability is something that is related to the network. It has to do with how the network is set up, and it can be completely decoupled with how pods are authorized to exchange traffic with each other. The authorization problem is essentially an application problem. It's not a networking problem. And by actually decoupling the two, we can come up with much simpler mechanisms that allows us to achieve security while maintaining a simple network implementation. So what is the solution? The solution is actually very simple, that every time we have a service, and by service, it can be a Kubernetes service or it can be a set of pods that are implementing the service that is trying to interact with another service, we need to introduce an end-to-end authentication and authorization step in between the services. So the underlying assumption then becomes that the internet is the network. We don't care, in other words, what is the network. The services can be in different clusters. They can be on the same cluster. Somebody can even deploy Kubernetes Federation with completely isolated clusters. The clusters can be in the same data center. They can be in the different data centers. We don't care where they are. What we care about is that every service has an identity or a form of an identity, and every interaction between services is authorized based on the identity of the services. And the mechanism for introducing this end-to-end authentication and authorization is pretty transparent to the workloads, so we don't need to modify the workloads in order to achieve that. Now, the reality is that a lot of the cloud scale providers are actually using very similar techniques inside their data centers for isolation, because they realize that the networking techniques can just not scale to the cloud-native environment. So how does Trireme now get into the picture and solve this transparent application authorization step? So the Trireme approach is actually very simple. Every application, every pod, if you want, that is activated through Kubernetes is usually associated with a set of labels, right? So when we create a pod through OpenShift or through Kubernetes, we associate a set of labels, that the application type is production, the instance is web, the image is Nginx, right? So these are classic labels information that we can immediately understand whether from the YAML file that described the container, the pod, or whether we can get the information from the Docker metadata, for example. So every time a pod gets activated, we actually receive these attributes that describe the pod. Similarly, every pod that is activated for application two, we receive these attributes that are defining this other pod. And then a Kubernetes policy, if you think about it, says, for example, that these pods in application two are willing to accept traffic from other pods that are tagged with a label instances equals web. That's essentially a Kubernetes policy that needs to be loaded once. The way now Trireme works is that when a pod tries to do a TCP request to access another pod, we actually grab this metadata, this essentially attributes that describe a pod, and we sign them with a local key, and then we attach them as payload on the SYN packet that allows the that initiates the communication between the two entities. So now this identity essentially of the pod, the signed and verified identity, is transmitted over the network. It doesn't matter what is the network technique used to transmit it, whether it's a tunnel or not a tunnel, whether it's the internet or whatever, it doesn't really matter. The SYN request is going to arrive at the host on the other side. And when it arrives at the host on the other side, we're going to validate the signature of the identity that has been set to us. We're going to check the identity locally against the policy that we have from Kubernetes. And if Kubernetes allows this communication to happen, we're going to propagate the SYN packet to the application. Now, on the reverse direction, we do the exact same thing, and we'll discuss the protocol in a little bit more detail, that when the receiver sends back the SYNAC packet, we get the identity now, or the set of labels that describe the receiver. We sign it, we send it back to the transmitter. The transmitter looks at the identity and then validates, is that somebody that I really meant to talk? And is that somebody that I'm really allowed to talk? And then if the validation is achieved, we send back the SYNAC packet to the transmitter. And that's how a connection is established. Now, the big benefit of this is that we have completely decoupled this security policy, this end-to-end network authorization from the underlying network connectivity. We don't look at IP addresses anywhere on this infrastructure in order to achieve this connectivity. We don't care if there are 7 layers of network address translations that have been introduced. We don't care if the one pod is in a cluster in AWS and the other pod is in a private cluster. We really don't care about any of the network details. And that's exactly the operational simplification. Instead of doing security based on IP addresses and port numbers, we do security based on identities at this level. So for someone that wants to understand now, if I add a node on the system, this is a node 1 operation. I don't need to go update any nodes or anything like that. When the node is activated, we know the labels of this node. We know the policy for this node. We don't need to go to any other host and introduce any ACLs or anything like that in order to enable communication to this node. Now, going in a little bit more detail for somebody that wants to understand how this basic protocol for mutual authorization works, it's actually using and it's overlaid on top of the TCP fast open options. The TCP fast open option is something that was recently released. It's part of the Linux kernel for maybe the last couple of years. And what essentially this allows you to do is it allows you to send payload on the TCP SYN and SYNACK packets. And you don't need to wait for the full TCP negotiation before you send the payload. So what we do in our case is we use this capability, but instead of sending payload on the TCP SYN and SYNACK packets, we actually exchange authorization information. So the way we do it is we actually get the labels, we call them attributes, and we also get we create a random number, and I'll explain why we create a random number. We get the labels, a random number, and we sign it on the transmitter, and we piggyback it on the TCP SYN packet using the TCP fast open option. This arrives on the server. The server validates the signature. It checks the attributes against policy. If it's authorized, it returns back a SYNACK packet. The SYNACK packet, again, uses the attributes of the server, in this case, together with a second random number. And it signs all these attributes and random number. The transmitter is going to validate now that the signature is again correct. It's going to validate the attributes against the policy again. And then the transmitter finally is going to send on the ACK packet a signature on top of the two random numbers. And why do we do that? Is we actually do that because by signing these random numbers, we can actually achieve protection against man-in-the-middle attacks or replay attacks or any other mechanism that can go in the middle and spoof packets. And note that this is a threat vector for attacks that is actually not available or not possible for any technique that is based on ACLs. Now, interestingly enough, for somebody that is a little bit of a history buff, a technique like that a similar type of technique was possible for several years now by using the SIPSO option in IP options without obviously the signatures and without the flexibility that this environment offers. And also for somebody that is very familiar with Red Hat systems will know that the SE Linux has some network extensions that can actually use the SIPSO option, although I don't think many people use other than potentially some government organizations. Finally, the payload can be encrypted optionally. So the solution can also do transparent encryption if what we decide as policies that we want to do transparent encryption. So the benefits of this approach is that there are no complex ACLs. The network is very simple. It doesn't require anything from the switches or routers on the network. The threat model allows us to is much stronger than a simple firewall or a simple ACL type mechanism because it prevents against man-in-the-middle attacks, replay spoofing attacks, TCP sequence number attacks. And the implementation front, it is implemented by encapsulating these tokens as JSON web tokens. Essentially, we use OAuth for processes, if you think about it, right? JSON web tokens is the way we communicate information for OAuth, but instead of using it at the application layer, we use it at the infrastructure for processes. And it can be configured both with a pre-shared key or through a PKI infrastructure using elliptic curves. Now, when it comes to Kubernetes, the implementation and the integration of Trireme to Kubernetes is actually very simple. A Trireme pod can be deployed using Kubernetes daemon sets. on any Kubernetes cluster, and the Trireme pod then goes into the middle and traps the syn, cnac, and nac packets on any communication between pods, and introduces the end-to-end authentication and authorization on any interaction with between pods. There is no controller in this implementation. There is no policy controller or anything like that. The Trireme instances that get deployed as through the Kubernetes daemon sets listen to the Kube API, subscribe to the Kube API. They get the policy updates or the policy create, the pod create notifications, and based on this, they implement end-to-end the authentication and authorization policy. So just to summarize, the benefits of the solution is we essentially decouple security from the network. What this allows us to do is it allows us to maintain a simple network without infrastructure complexities, and at the same time, get strong security. And that's kind of like getting your pie, having your pie and eating it all, but that's essentially the result. The approach is very simple. It doesn't require any shared state. It doesn't have any control plane, if you want. And for this reason, it's very scalable. And for this reason, it becomes very easy to deploy and use. And in order to illustrate some of these things, I will pass over the screen to Bernard now. And Bernard is going to show you a demo of how you can deploy the Trireme security solution in a Kubernetes cluster. So Diane, if we can switch over to Bernard now, please.
Okay, can you see me?
Yes.
Hi everyone, what I want to show you today is basically an illustration of what Dimitri just explained. So I'm going to use...
Yeah, you're not quite sure, there you go.
Here we go, perfect. Okay, so I want to demo basically what Dimitri just explained. So to do this, I'm going to use a typical Kubernetes cluster. So my cluster is running into AWS. It's a typical Kube AWS cluster. If you use OpenShift, it will be the same thing underlined. Okay. So just to illustrate this, I'm going to use kubectl. And I have currently two nodes ready to be scheduled and one controller node. And what we want to do is to show the typical steps needed to deploy Trireme with Kubernetes, and then start a couple of pods, implement network policies, and show how Trireme makes this super simple. So the first thing the first thing you will need to do if you want to deploy Trireme is to deploy Trireme itself. So to do this, we implemented what we call a daemon set. So this is standard Kubernetes, and it's a construct that allows you to deploy one pod and one pod only on each node part of the cluster. And so as Dimitri explained, what you want is you want basically the Trireme agent running on each node that will trap the syn, cnac, and ACK packets of each TCP connection that is initiated. And those will be redirected to the Trireme agent. That's why you need one of those agents on each node. And again, we don't have a central policy controller. So that agent is the only thing that you really need to install. And it's made super simple by just having to deploy that simple daemon set. So this is basically the daemon set. What it shows you, it's deploying the Trireme Kubernetes image. We give it a couple of parameters. This is pretty standard. So I'm just going to do a kubectl create. And by the way, as Dimitri said, we support encryption. And by default, you can do it with a pre-shared key or a PKI. To make it simple, I'm going to use the pre-shared key daemon set. Okay. -f. Here we go. And now if I check my pods, I can see that Trireme started to schedule Kubernetes schedule one Trireme agent on each up and running node. Okay. So right now we got a Kubernetes cluster which is up and running with Trireme installed. You just have to start pods and implement network policies, and automatically Trireme will pick up those constructs and start implementing those network policies in the background. Okay. So this, I created a new namespace, which is my demo namespace. And so one of the things you need to do, and this is following the specification from network policies on Kubernetes, is you need to define your namespace as being default deny. If you don't do this by default, everything is allowed. So on my demo namespace, I simply added an annotation, because this is still beta today, and that defines that by default, you will just drop every packet unless you explicitly allow them to communicate between pods. Okay, and those will be defined on your network policies themselves. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is start a couple of pods. So I'm just going to start my typical three-tier application. So in a three-tier application, you got typically an external tier, which is completely outside the system. This is this pod. You have like a front-end pod, which will typically represent your load balancer. And then let's say you have a back-end pod, which is your business back-end, which should never be allowed to communicate directly with any external pod. And so what we want to do is we want to start those three pods. And then I will have policies that will implement a very simple policy that in order to reach the backend, only the front end should be able to open that TCP connection. Basically, any external pod should not be able to directly reach the backend pods. Okay. And so again, this is made very simple by using the Kubernetes and OpenShift labels. So everything is a label in Kubernetes and OpenShift. So you just need to, instead of saying that you match explicitly on a specific pod, you match on a set of labels. So in this case, we'll basically match on the whole business backend, and you will specifically define that only the front-end label, so the web front-end, will be allowed to communicate with that backend. Okay, so in order to do this, I'm just going to go to my policy examples, and again, deploy into my namespace my three pods. There we go. Perfect. And so at this point, running into my namespace all of those pods. And let's do a very simple test, because by default, we define that the demo namespace should not be allowed to send traffic between each pods on that namespace. I'm just simply going to try to communicate between front-end and back-end, and this will be completely denied. Okay, so let me just grab the IP of the back-end pod. Okay, here we go. And so what you can see is you get the labels and you get the specific IP. I'm just going to do a kubectl exec. This basically should allow us to issue a simple wget to my backend pod. Here we go. And it's denied. And so this is Trireme right now blocking those TCP connections. And later on, when I will implement the network policy, so when I will create the network policy, and that when we will basically explicitly allow that TCP connection to be opened, you will see that it will be allowed. Okay. So let me go back and show you exactly what the three-tier policy is. So those are the standard Kubernetes network policies. I'm basically matching on the web front-end as a label, so not as a pod, but as a label. And I'm describing that the front end should be able to communicate between each other. So this is this policy. And then I have my backend policy, basically describing that when you match the business backend label, both the front end and the other backend should be able to open communications to it. And so this TCP connection to the backend. Okay. So we have an external pod that will be able to demonstrate this. So from external, which is outside the backend tier, you should never be able to open a TCP connection to your backend. Okay. So in order to do this, I again need to if your kubectl creates API is a bit slow. Did I lost my
connection?
Yeah, that's real. Yeah. Okay, that's a first. Well, if I don't have access to my cluster, I will probably not be able to demo this to you.
Yes, because it's a live demo.
Yeah, it's live. I mean, and usually I do it on a local cluster, but in this case, it's on my AWS one.
Can you try
to associate
something?
I also lost it, so. Wait, I got it back, I think. Let's see. Extremely, yeah, here we go. Yeah. Here we go. Okay, perfect. That was interesting. Live demos.
We survived network failures.
There you go.
Okay, so right now I basically created all my network policies into Kubernetes. Here we go. And so now if I go back to my ping, this is working. So basically, by explicitly allowing it into the network policy, we allow only that specific flow, so from the front end to the back end, to be opened. But if I go, for example, to my external pod, if I try to do the same thing, here we go, it's still denied. And so basically, what we do here is that Trireme is implementing in a very efficient way those network policies, right? You don't have any central controller. Each Trireme agent on each node is opening a watcher API, basically an API connection to the Kubernetes API, and we only get the information related to the local pods. And so we have a completely efficient implementation of those network policies. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty much it for the demo.
All right. Well, thank you, Bernard. Perhaps if you go back to sharing your screen, Dimitri, so that we can have the end slide and yep. Asking some questions, and hopefully your last slide has your how to contact you information on it. If not, start typing furiously. And there were, I think Mark had a question or two, so I think what I might do now is, unless there's some other points that you wanted to make, Dimitri?
Just one point, code for all these things is available on GitHub. The information is on this slide. Feel free to visit it. There is a Slack channel there. If you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask.
Okay. Bernard is still sharing his screen. And so he's got to stop sharing his screen, and you have to share your screen, Dimitri.
Okay, hold on.
Yeah. And it's just a little blue jeans technical stuff. So we get a beautiful shot of Bernard's face right now. And we'll go back to the end slide of yours. And Mark, I'm going to unmute you if you would like to ask your question. You just have to unmute yourself.
Perfect. Can you all hear me?
I can hear you, Mark. Yep.
Sweet. This is cool stuff, guys. The policies and the identities, is it all right now static through the YAML configuration, or is there some kind of way to either assert the identities or store it somewhere in some kind of repository?
So on the implementation that is out there right now, at least on the Kubernetes integration implementation, the identity is auto-created based on the Kubernetes pods. However, the way that Trireme is designed, if somebody looks at the library, it allows what we call an external metadata extractor. We call this is a function, is a metadata extractor. And this extractor can be anything, can get the identity from anywhere that it feels like getting it. So you can pretty much run a script there. You can integrate the library with other code and go to other things there. It's very open and modular on where it can get the identity from or what exactly is the identity. The key issue is that the key thing that it does is it grabs all this identity information and encapsulates it in a JSON web token and signs this JSON web token. So the identity eventually is captured as a JSON web token.
Okay. Because kind of the use case I'm thinking that something like this would be really interesting for is if you had, let's say you had a Mongo database, right? And you want to control access to it. Well, something like this would be really cool to say, well, I'm gonna have a team that they know Mongo databases, right? That's all they know. And we're going to deploy it on Kubernetes because Kubernetes is awesome. And to control access to it, we're going to authorize applications via a service like this to lock down who's getting to it. And so if there was a way to be able to dynamically do that, and then even more importantly on the deauthorization. So, oh, yeah. Your pod's doing something weird. I don't like that. I wanna stop that access. That would give you a layer of protection even over something like a service account at the database level. So if somebody compromised that pod, you could just turn them off at this layer too without shutting down the entire application.
Exactly. You get the point, right? That's the exact use cases that we're thinking also about. Right now on the Kubernetes integration, this can be done by modifying the labels. The network policy in Kubernetes doesn't have yet, it's a whitelist policy, right? So the one thing that is missing, and we hope we can work with the community to deal with that, is you cannot fence off an application with this policy. You have to explicitly go say what is allowed. Potentially, you can do some fence off things like that by using the not operator, but it can become a little bit trickier. So the policy model can be extended, but I think it's already gives you a lot of things you can do. And as you said, that's some of the classic examples, right? I think last week somebody discovered that the whole set of, you mentioned MongoDB, MongoDB databases have been pwned and somebody removed the data and is asking for ransomware. Why? Because the MongoDB databases were listening to 000 and it was just too complex to deal with ACLs and all these kind of things, right? With a solution like Trireme, the entities that can access MongoDB are explicitly authenticated and authorized based on their identities at this layer, maybe if you want at the infrastructure layer. And so the developers don't need to worry whether they deployed MongoDB with the 000 option or they deployed it with the right IP address, right? And deploying MongoDB with the right IP address when you use Kubernetes, for example, to deploy it is quite tricky to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, exactly. That's the exact use case I was thinking of.
Yeah.
And the MongoDB apocalypse is kind of top of mind for a lot of people. It's a great example.
It's no fault of MongoDB, right?
It's
databases, right? It's just that these guys get the bad publicity now.
I know. I feel bad for them, and you know. I think it's good, at least, that it's exposed a weakness in the deployment models for people. So I think it's a good thing. It raises some awareness.
Exactly. And
gives us a way to go forward. Did you have another question, Mark, or?
No, that was the big one. It is, like I said, it's really cool stuff.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting. I mean, I have to frankly say that I had really not a very good understanding before the talk about what you were trying to accomplish here. And it seems to me this is one of those projects that might benefit from being under the auspices of something like the CNCF. Have you guys thought about approaching them and having this project there so that, I'm going to say it wrong, I'm sure, Trireme would get more eyeballs and more resources working on it from the Kubernetes and all of the other cloud native.
Yeah, this is actually something we're in discussions, and we are actually in the process of doing some paperwork to join CNCF ourselves first and take it from there.
Perfect. Yeah, it seems like it could really benefit from having more Kubernetes engineering resources looking at it. Have you done integrations with other orchestrations, or is this really strictly something that runs on top of Kubernetes? Are you working with Mesos or?
It will actually work with pretty much anything. We have done integrations with Mesos. It can even work with Docker Swarm if somebody wants to use it there. So it doesn't really depend on the orchestration framework. The advantage that Kubernetes has is Kubernetes has a mechanism to express network policy. Mesos is still in the process of trying to figure out how to express this policy. But I think they will be following up shortly, and I'm sure Docker Swarm will be following up shortly, right? So, and by the way, it doesn't also, the way it's designed, it doesn't really depend on Docker either. So somebody can use OCI or can use any other container format and achieve the same functions.
That's why it makes it really, it seems to me, something that's very useful for lots of cloud native applications and folks in this sphere. So I'm looking forward to seeing more of it, and hopefully we'll see some of you at KubeCon in EU up in the upcoming months. I think KubeCon is in March in Berlin, and I'm hoping that we'll see some of this and where you've gone with it since then. We'll also hopefully get you to come and talk at the upcoming OpenShift Commons gathering, which is going to be in Berlin as well, co-located with KubeCon. So hopefully we can get you talking there. And I think what I'd like to do is get you and Aporeto and others more involved in a security special interest group with the OpenShift Commons and see if we can get some more eyeballs from the OpenShift ecosystem on this project as well. So I really appreciate you taking the time today. I'm looking to see if anybody else has any other questions in there. If so, just raise your hands. Otherwise, I'm sure you can find the contact information on their GitHub links or on their websites to this project. And we look forward to you guys being incredibly successful. So thanks again.
Thanks, Diane, for organizing this.
All right. You take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.